talk, we hear stories about our guests and, you know, their very nerdy upbringings and how they fell in love with computers. Do you have one of those iconic stories of you and a Commodore 64?
I mean, so there's a little bit of feedback. I grew up in the UK.
Uh-huh.
I'm a half English, half French. And my first experience with computers was were tape-based. You remember, right, like PATs?
Uh-huh.
You remember PAT computers and like tape-based computers? So it was really early days. And then when I came to the States, when I was 17 to go to university. And that sort of more immersed me into sort of computers and computer landscape and so on. There wasn't much in England. But I was, I think from a very early age, I would say that I'm sort of innately, I'm a tinkerer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I love even today sort of taking things apart and trying to solve problems. And that sort of, you know, that tinkering sort of aspect of my character is a big piece of what we do at Betaworks, and
mm-hmm.
it's sort of that's been a theme throughout my career.
Does that sort of extend to like hardware too? Like, are you someone who like working on cars? Are you someone who like?
I mean, I used to
take things apart.
Yeah, when I was a kid, I would take things apart, and I would try to put them back together again, and
mm-hmm.
sometimes I would succeed, and sometimes I wouldn't. But I love. Sort of, hardware, software. I mean, I would love, you know, anything. Steam, like, you know, those like kids Steam things. I blew one of those up. I mean, I enjoy. I mean, I do it with my kids now. I enjoy taking things apart and understanding how they work.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So,
is it less satisfying doing that in software?
I really like. Let me make a point here. I really like. I really like being able to get in on inside of technology. I mean, I think that one of the things that today I think is very important as we architect, you know, what we're building and how we build things, is to still allow people to get inside of technology.
What do you mean, get inside of technology?
I mean, like, I'm thinking there was a wonderful piece I read years ago by Neil Stephenson called "In the Beginning Was the Command Line."
Mm-hmm.
And he talked, it's a 15-page essay. It's not like a Stevenson tome. It's an essay. And he talks about the fact that the command line, and he talks about Windows and the Apple GUI and the interface.
Mm-hmm.
And he talks about, you know, this this veneer that is placed on top of computing by the interface.
Mm-hmm.
And how that manages the interactions, and you know, people slowly become, the command line becomes more and more abstracted.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, ultimately you don't have access to it.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, you can fire up terminal, but it's like, it's way down there in the stack.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that with technology, period, I mean, I was talking about this with some people a couple of weeks ago about sort of how algorithms are becoming a similar layer. You know, so I like to be able to pierce through.
Uh-huh.
And I think it's very important that we can, because I think it's important that we understand the technology that we're building and that we have access to the sort of the cogs and the wheels inside of it.
That's interesting, because a lot of people feel like platforms like, you know, Apple's or Facebook's, and just, you know, the LAMP stack that's been created has sort of freed people up from the real technology.
Yeah.
And has allowed people to be designers and creatives but not coders and still build companies. So do you think that's been a bad trend?
I wouldn't say bad. I mean, I think that, you know, good and bad are just, you know, they're very binary, easy, and sort of concepts, which I think here in the West we and particularly the media love, because
mm-hmm.
it, you know, sets up, it polarizes points of views, and then you can use that for everything from debate to link bait.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wouldn't say good or bad. I mean, look, if you think about New York tech,
mm-hmm.
if you think about what we do at Betaworks, I mean, we've been both huge. We've invested hugely in the in the design and the interface layer of, you know, what this new world that we're collectively building is becoming. So I think it's there's a lot of good things about it, but there are some bad things about it. And I think that being able to pierce through it is really important. You know, one of the things I love about Twitter still is that, you know, you could get to the rawness of the stream, right? An issue I've always had with Facebook, ever since I, you know, when it first, you know, the day after it came out of the college market into the broad market, I signed up for it. I was like, the algorithm applied to the feed, to me, was just like something I didn't want, right? I just wanted the rawness of the feed. And then I wanted to be able to filter that myself. Mm-hmm. So it's just, you know, I think that that kind of access is important.
Interesting. Do you think that that's, I mean, that seems a more Silicon Valley point of view. I think there's always an obsession with openness of information, being able to take your information with you, being able to get down to things. Do you think that's a more Valley point of view in New York? Do you think people have that sort of getting inside the technology obsession?
Yeah, I don't consider that Valley point of view. I mean, you know, Apple was famously anti that. And so I think that it's definitely a point of view that some people propagate in the Valley and mm-hmm. you know, believe in the Valley, but I think you see both. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's a New York versus Valley thing. Mm-hmm. We could do some of those if you want, but there are some of those, but I don't think it's that.
Well, I do want to talk about the sort of early Silicon Alley days in New York, because I know you were, so when you got your start and you were building different sites and selling things and running around. And, you know, a lot of people have talked about how what's going on in New York now, you know, really is an outgrowth of sort of those seeds of that era, even the things that didn't work out so well, even though immediately after it, people might have thought, oh, that was all sort of a failure. So how did you wind up in the original Silicon Alley scene? When did you get involved in it? And
so I started off in 94.
Okay.
The journey for me was really, it really started with a drink.
As many good things
alcohol,
do in life.
Yeah. And so I, in 91, I was working here in the city, and I was working for a consulting firm. Mm-hmm. And we did a lot of data intensive stuff, and we did a lot of analytical stuff, great group of people that I was working with there. And we got asked by Reuters, the news organization, by their board, to sort of plot out what the world of information delivery would look like by the turn of the century. Mm-hmm. Right. So this is 1991, and they were trying to look 10 years hence. Mm-hmm. You know, what will information delivery look like, and how will their world look? And remember, Reuters, I mean, most people think of it as a news organization. It's really, most of it is a financial information delivery platform. Mm-hmm. Stock, bonds, prices, all that stuff. So anyway, so I did what consultants do, is that they paid us a fair amount of money for us to go and talk to all the experts and form an opinion. Mm-hmm. And many of the experts were actually their country regional managers. Mm-hmm. And I was actually tagged with going to Asia and to Europe and to interview each of the regional managers for Reuters about what the future would look like. And so I met with, I had a bunch of interesting meetings, but I met with the guy who ran Reuters in France. Mm-hmm. And we had a long chat in his office. And then he said, young man, let's just go and have lunch. We should continue this over lunch. And so he was very French, and he ordered wine. Mm-hmm. And at the end of lunch is that he looked at the wine in his glass, and he said, you know, I want to be able to sell that on the network. And I want to be able to sell wine on the network. Mm-hmm. And so we talked for about another hour about that. We talked about how you could use private networks. You know, there was the beginning of sort of small networks that were being used commercially, mostly for financial services. Mm-hmm. And Reuters had one like that, right? And mm-hmm. so a couple of probably a couple of thousand people on either on the network. Mm-hmm. So small, but it was. But I was fascinated by that. So then, fast forward, I went to business school, mm-hmm. went to Wharton in '92, and which was kind of a waste of time. But
was it?
It was. I mean, the best thing happened at Wharton was I met my wife, and so you know, Blair was. The best thing that came out of the MBA education for me. I spent a lot of time at, one of the things which was great about Penn and Wharton actually was that they had a very good computer science school, right? And so I did a bunch of courses in other areas of the school. You can cross over into Penn, and I did computer science courses, I did a Sanskrit course, I did a bunch of different things, I had fun. But it was, as an education, it was not, the MBA itself was not worth either the time or the money. But when I was there, I started tinkering with a lot of the early online networks, right? So, mm-hmm. you know, we're starting to see these private networks, if people remember them, you know, CompuServe, AOL, and sort of these non-web-based networks that were, you know, doing email and other things. And so I started playing around with them. And then in my second year at Wharton, I had a friend of mine who was working at the AI lab up at MIT. Mm-hmm. And he called me up and he said, we have a terminal here where we have the World Wide Web running on terminal. Mm-hmm. And so this is, we're talking about 93, late 93. The browser was, this was pre-Netscape, right? So Netscape hadn't been formed yet. And so, was it called Spy something? I've forgotten. It was, you know. Anyway, I drove up to Boston mm-hmm. from Philadelphia to go see the web, right? So drove like 4 hours because I was fascinated by this. And this friend of mine, Mark Bonchek, showed me in the AI lab, they had one computer, it was a Unix computer, and they had a web browser on it. Mm-hmm. And we pulled up a couple of web pages, and there was a French guy who had a website which was called Le Louvre Web or something, mm-hmm. where he'd taken sort of 10 pictures of the Louvre Museum in Paris and stuck them up on the web. Mm-hmm. And I remember sitting there, you know, and the images would take about 10 minutes to render, so line by line you'd see the images coming in. And I got in my car and I drove back to Philadelphia, and I said to the woman who became my wife, I said, you know, I've seen the future. This is what is going to change the world of media and information delivery. And then I was like, I was fraught with panic. Mm-hmm. Because I couldn't graduate fast enough, and I was convinced that it would be like, it would grow up and get commercialized within 6 months.
Why did you feel like that was, I mean, because to people who come up and experience the web now, that sounds like a pretty shitty web experience. Why was seeing a picture roll in line by line, why was it so transformative?
Well, because it was, you know, the very, very simple, you know, the idea that somebody has, you know, it's the base client architecture, the distributed client architecture of the web, right? Mm-hmm. Some guy, Nicholas Pinochet, no, I forgot what his name was. That it was Nicholas something. He had a computer in Paris, underneath his desk, and that I was sitting there in Boston, looking at a page which he had authored. Mm-hmm. Right, so it's the distributed architecture of the web and the ease of authoring, mm-hmm. right? And it was, we're talking blinking text, we're talking very early. I mean, I went also to the, about a month later, I went to the first or the second World Wide Web conference, which was in Chicago. Mm-hmm. And at that conference, Netscape, it was announced just afterwards, I think. Mm-hmm. But the conference was fascinating because 80% of the people at the conference were academics, mm-hmm. and 80 or 90, there were very few people who weren't academics. And when I say academics, it's like really research people who wanted to, were building on the internet as a research tool. Mm-hmm.
But you thought this will be a mass consumer thing. When you first saw it and thought, I've got to get out of school quickly, did you think about what applications would be developed for it? How much did it bear in reality to how we use the web today?
Well, I think I was massively wrong in terms of like the time scale that I thought it would develop. I had this very firm belief that this medium was different, and the things that would be built on this medium needed to be fundamentally different. Maybe today we call that native, or sort of endemic to the medium. Mm-hmm. And I thought we'd figure out the medium much quicker than we did. And so I think that I was kind of amazed, 10 years later, say, just to take a point in time, I was kind of amazed at how quickly we were to impose upon the medium our sort of templates from other media forms. Uh-huh. Right? So the browser came along, right? And they made a very fundamental architecture decision with the browser that, if you go back to Tim Berners-Lee spec, right, read and write word equal weighting, right? But the browser, the very metaphor of a browser, calling the thing a browser, was fundamentally a view browsing tool. Mm-hmm. And so the write aspect of the web, suddenly when Netscape came out, it was like 80-90% read and 10% write. Mm-hmm. And so, and I think that for the first decade after that, it was that. And then gradually we've seen that sort of, balance out. I think there's still a bias. And the metaphors all came from print pages. They came from sort of our understanding of cartology and maps, mm-hmm. navigation, browser, back button, forward button, direction, and architecture, mm-hmm. sites, physicality. We were trying to anchor this sort of, this totally boundless thing in some metaphors that we understood. Mm-hmm. And we're still trying to do that, right? And we're still boxing it in a lot of times by our understanding that we bring to it from other media and from other things.
Do you try to peel that away at Betaworks?
Yeah.
Can you give us some examples?
Well, I think that one of the things that is different that we do at Betaworks is, we're building a collection of things, right? And so the belief is that when we started Betaworks up about 5.5 years ago, is there were a couple of ideas that sort of we put on the table, and we said, these things we hold true, or these are the things that we're going to believe that we're going to. And so one of them was that there was another big shift coming, right? Because I think that the web sort of got in a period of stasis for about 7-8 years, and Google was like benign dictator over the web. Mm-hmm. And they were a nice dictator. I think of all the dictators we could have chosen, I'm glad we didn't choose AOL as an industry. I think that Todd's laughing, an ex-AOLer. So they were a benign dictator, but they were still a dictator, right? And they, traffic flows, just, Google dominated. And so one thing we concluded was the world was changing, and it was going to get upended again by several transformations. One was social, another one was the move to devices, and move to touch-based interfaces, phones, watches, all this stuff. It was all going to get opened up again and redefined. So that was one thing. The second thing is that the system that we have for innovation, I thought a lot about it, and so my career, I went from a couple of hours at the AI lab, fast forward to leaving Wharton, starting my first company. I could talk about that later, but selling that to AOL, mm-hmm. staying at AOL for a couple of years, doing a bunch of things at AOL, then moving to Time Warner after the AOL acquisition, taking taking the job of the CTO at Time Warner and running the team there at Time Warner, looking across all tech at Time Warner, and then leaving Time Warner and starting again as an entrepreneur. And when I came out and started again as an entrepreneur, I believed firmly that this innovation model that we had didn't seem to scale very well. It's like I was fascinated by the fact that you have these incredible companies that are born, right? So let's talk about some people today or some people from yesteryear. Look, I mean, AOL, Yahoo was a phenomenally innovative company once upon a time. Mm-hmm. And Marissa Mayer may be revitalizing that today. But you know, Yahoo has not innovated much in the last 5 years.
Right.
Right? I think that, you know, eBay was a phenomenally innovative company and it stopped. Right, I see signs that Facebook is, you know, sort of reaching that edge where they're not innovating the way they were. So why is it that these incredible companies get born, fantastic innovation, and then they grow and they grow and they grow and they grow and they can't innovate anymore, and they end up innovating just by making random acquisitions, right? Which they then can't necessarily fit into the puzzle or make sense, and. You know, one of the things I think about is that if you take the web, right, and if you could pick up the web, right, and look at it from underneath, right, what you'd see is you just see these clusters of data, right, and data just moving around in servers and just like clusters of data, right, and the clusterings would be around these things that we call corporations, mm-hmm. right. There'll be some nonprofits in there, and there's Wikipedia, and there's, you know, other things, but a lot of them are corporations. And the corporate structure is something that we impose upon. You know, the web doesn't, the technology isn't bounded by that, right? We've imposed these boxes on top of these data sets and said, that's a corporation, and this is the wall of the corporation. And there'll be some rules by which data or business, you know, which will interact beyond that to another corporation. And those may be APIs for data, and they may be, you know, legal agreements for partnerships and so on. But we've then imposed this structure. And yet, if you look at how people, users, engineers, how people build, I wouldn't say they're blind to those things, but they're not constricted by them. Mm-hmm. Right? They want their data, users want their data to be available,
right.
Portable. And I believed firmly that this new era, when we started 5 years ago, would be characterized as there would be several big companies, a handful of big companies. So it wouldn't be the monolithic era of Google. There would be a bunch of big companies. And I think that's played out, right? You can see, right. I mean, Facebook's clearly a huge company, but Twitter's a huge company and very successful. And LinkedIn's a big company and they're a player, and so, you know, and then maybe you can argue about Snapchat or Foursquare or Path or, you know, or Tumblr, but, you know, we're not living in a monoculture. And so, because we're living in this world of diversity and diversity of platforms, right, it's not Windows and Google, it's not just a single platform world, data has to move between those things, and data wants to move, because as it moves, it actually gains context, and it gains value. Mm-hmm. Right, so going all the way back, you told me this thing is like an hour and a half, so I'm giving you the whole version of this, okay?
Yeah.
So, but going back to your question, is that we said, A, can we create a company, Betaworks, where we can actually sustain and continue to innovate?
Uh-huh.
Right, so that's a big idea. That's a hard thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something we're trying to do, right? And I think thus far, we've got some really good seeds of that. So number one is, can we create that? Can we create a company that actually promotes the connections between these things, right? And so, you know, going back a bit, is we create something like Bitly, and then Bitly is integrated into something like TweetDeck, which we've invested in, and it's integrated into a bunch of other things. And, you know, and we promote those connections, particularly at the data level. And that, from Betaworks' standpoint, is that the more the data moves, the more those services are used, the better, right? Because we have stakes in all these companies. And so we look at Betaworks as a as an ecosystem and not as a monoculture or not as a single point thing,
right?
And we're trying to grow it like that. And so the idea is that can we create a company that is a big company, that is a that can sustain innovation, mm-hmm. and can look at like 20 years of innovation and can grow through that, and also one where there's a lot of pieces, and the pieces, some of them are tightly connected or coupled, and then some of them are more loosely coupled.
Right. So does this mean you don't want anything that you guys create at Betaworks to become such a breakout hit that it overshadows all the others?
Oh, no. That would be stupid, right?
But the architecture, you're describing, if you're talking about something like Google, it is dominated by paid search because that is such a good business.
Yeah,
I mean, Google's
yeah.
tried many, many attempts, has spent billions in acquisitions to try to diversify from that, and it doesn't work. I mean, this is sometimes an accidental thing.
If we're Williams and the obvious version one, right?
Right.
And so try a bunch of stuff, and Twitter was one of the things, and bang, right?
Right.
So, I think that everything we do is, you know, we love big, right? We love scaling things, right? Bitly grew to a huge scale very fast. We love that. Mm-hmm. We're fairly obsessed with habit and habit-forming things, mm-hmm. right? And the word in our business for that is engagement, right? We love habit-forming things, right? So one of the filters that we use for the things that we create at Betaworks is that something you'd want to use every day? Mm-hmm. Is that something you want to, you know? And so when I see a tweet out there where somebody says, you know, I wake up in the morning to Poncho's weather report, I use check into Digg, I shorten my links with Bitly, and I and when I want some downtime, I play darts. Mm-hmm. I love that, right? And so we want, you know, multiple touch points, and we want to see the engagement around those things. We love big things, but the architecture of Betaworks is we're trying to create this platform where we can grow multiple things. And so, I mean, the question is one we've batted around, you know, and talked about what if. I mean, look, this platform, there is massive network effects and mm-hmm. scale that can occur on this platform. And so if we planted a seed that grew like that, like Google, mm-hmm. It would probably, just to use sort of so I feel like we're using ecological metaphors, but it would just sort of like tree-wise, it would just like the roots of that would upend a lot of other stuff.
Right.
I hope it wouldn't upend everything. Mm-hmm. Because we're really trying to build a company and a platform that we can sustain and grow innovation.
Mm-hmm. I feel like there's such an obsession in a lot of the venture world with, okay, that's interesting, but can that be a $1 billion company?
Yeah.
And it keeps a lot of things that would be really cool that a lot of people would love and maybe use every day from getting developed.
Right.
I mean, one of the things as an outsider, one of the ways that I think about Betaworks is that you go ahead and develop a lot of things that a VC might say, well, that's a feature, not a business, or
right.
that's not a $1 billion company. Do you think of, what is the filter by which you think about things? Does it have to be big, or does it just have to be interesting?
It has to be habit forming, and it's part of what people's everyday life is. It has to be interesting. It has to fit into sort of the design ethos that we're trying to build at Betaworks. It has to be something people can love, right? I mean, it's, if you look at Tapestry, you know, one of the products, tools, businesses we've created, mm-hmm. you know, the words that people use around Tapestry, the engagement, the emotional engagement people have around it is phenomenal. Mm-hmm. And that reflects in the sort of completion rate of when people are tapping through reading stories, mm-hmm. Which is way up there in terms of it's like 85%, which is phenomenal. They have to be things that we love. I mean, we are we're picky, and also the people. I mean, people are like such an incredibly important piece of they're the it's the individuals you interact with day in and day out. It has to be the kind of people. But you know, to your question of $1 billion, that's not the primary filter that I impose upon things, that we impose upon things. Mm-hmm. And why? Because I think that's a stupid filter. Mm-hmm. I think it's a stupid filter because it's asking, can that change the world, or can that change the way people read, in the case of Tapestry, or discover, in the case of Digg, or play, in the case of Dots? You know, can it change the world? Can it change people's lives? That's a good question. Mm-hmm. But $1 billion is like, you know, you couldn't, I don't think you could have said to me, you could roll the clock back and talk to Sergey and Larry and say, would this be $1 billion? They were trying to navigate the web, mm-hmm. right? They're trying to solve a very hard problem in a elegant way. Mm-hmm. And so I think that $1 billion filter, yeah, I just think that's a ruse. I just think that, can it change the world? Can it change people's lives? That's a good filter. Mm-hmm. And I also think that, you know, to the VC question, I think that one of the things that we have today is that, you know, we have this, I mean, the VC model is an incredible model, right? And it's a very, very fine-tuned and well-tuned, like, screwdriver. But I think we're in a world where there should be other tools, right? And, you know, some things require a Kickstarter, some things require a Betaworks site model, some things require an accelerator or tech school like Techstars, like Y Combinator kind of model. Mm-hmm. And so some things are just people want to bootstrap and put them in the App Store and, as a paid app. And
right.
So I think we've got this massive increase at the bottom of innovation. And the VC model is just an incredible model. It was created initially to solve a different problem. Right? Mm-hmm. It was created to solve a problem related to hardware innovation.
Right.
And then that worked very well for internet infrastructure. Mm-hmm. And it worked pretty darn well for internet, big internet, sort of at a certain layer in the stack. I think that one of the things that doesn't do a good job is that, and this goes to the crash actually, is that it tends to build a lot of really tall trees, or it tries to build just tall trees, right? Mm-hmm. And so I use the analogy sometimes of, you know, that the internet and what we have today is like kind of like the rainforest. You walk into the rainforest and you think it's this incredible ecological event, mm-hmm. incredible forest. But rainforests are actually very fragile.
Uh-huh.
They have really, really fertile undergrowth and then really big trees that make it to the canopy and get sunlight. Mm-hmm. But there's very little in between.
Right.
And I think that that makes the system kind of unstable. Mm-hmm. And I think that the VC model does some of that.
Yeah.
And so, you know, having some things in the middle, I think is actually a really good thing because it can build more sustainable businesses and a more sustainable system for innovation.
Do you think part of that is the fact that most of the internet is ad-based, and in order to get the enough revenues, you need to become either really, really gargantuan and build enough scale that then you can have sort of display ads running across it like Facebook does?
Yeah.
Or, you know, you are this sort of tiny publication that just never gets to scale and there's no other way to monetize. I mean, it seems like the monetization is what drives a lot of that.
Yeah.
You've got to get 1 billion users.
Yeah, I think, and that goes to back to sort of Google's benign dictatorship, right? Because I think that, you know, they had an incredibly effective model of monetization, which you can call advertising. It's not really advertising, right? It's, you know, it's an auction. It's closer to direct marketing than it is to traditional advertising. But I think that that a myth was propagated, and I'm not saying anybody was bad. You know, the Google generated this because I don't think anybody intended to. But I think a myth was propagated across the web that advertising, you could support yourself through advertising and use Google tools and so on and so forth, right? I think we should have started much earlier with other business models, mm-hmm. right? And so, you know, I think it was really unfortunate that, I mean, it's great, very happy for Venmo and for Braintree and what they're building, but it was really unfortunate that PayPal was kind of cut off in its prime. You know, I always wondered, I remember back in the day, what would have happened if, you know, the browsers had integrated payments in there, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, because what is iTunes, right? It's a shell, it's a browser. You know, you periodically get these errors in there because of the server. I mean, they serve up HTTP in there in a lot of the windows. It's a browser, mm-hmm. but it's got payments integrated into it, right? Uh-huh. And so why could the actual browser not do that? And I think that could have changed, you know, quite a bit of the business model.
Interesting. Yeah, because even getting someone to pay a penny is so hard.
Yeah.
On the web.
Yeah.
How do you feel about Bitcoin? A lot of people have said that one of the reasons they're super bullish on it is almost this sense of anonymity and the sense that it's like this general ledger of the web where, you know, this thing has this intrinsic value and you don't have to have a credit card number or authentication, and in some ways that sort of opens payments up beyond even sort of boundaries. Are you bullish on Bitcoin?
Look, I'm fascinated. I mean, cryptocurrency, which I'll say generally, because I think Bitcoin is one of, there will be several flavors of it. Mm-hmm. You know, let's talk about cash for a second. Cash is a, you know, cash was a phenomenal invention, right? And you know, it goes back a couple of thousand years, right? I mean, there's like cash has been used. But even 100 years ago, right, here in New York, right, you were the issuing banks, you know, would, you know, cash came from like Citibank or the Citibank of New York. I remember, I mean, a long time ago, I remember researching this. And so I think cash has took a long time to evolve. But you know, the fact that I can give you $5 and the fact you can give it to him and mm-hmm. that we all agree it's $5 and that we all agree that that he now owns it, mm-hmm. But there's no trace of where it came from is, you know, is very, very powerful. Mm-hmm. So I think cryptocurrency, like Bitcoin and other things, are going to be a big piece of the of what we're going to build and the ecosystem. I think it's a big invention. Mm-hmm. And it's going to change a lot, and it has a lot of the characteristics that I've seen before. Sort of, it has the wild woolly sort ofness uh-huh. of the beginning of the web. You know that we've wrung some of that wildness out of the web,
right?
And I think it has some of that, right? It's which is fascinating. And yeah, so I'm fascinated by it.
Uh-huh.
And we have, you know, Nick over at Betaworks has been playing around with. I'll tell you a story. It's fun. So we had a friend at a large VC who called us about one of the Bitcoin companies and said, you know, we're going to make an investment and we'd love to see if you guys want to join us. We think you'd be fascinated by the company. And yeah. We took a look at it, and we thought it was fascinating. And Nick Charles, who runs investments at Betaworks, is by training he's a math guy, and he sort of jumped into it. And he came in one Monday morning. He said, "I spent the whole weekend." He said, "I had to go to CVS to like get a money order," but he walked through the whole process. But he was like, "This is fascinating," mm-hmm. and so. So then what happened was, this was a couple of months back, and there was like a feeding frenzy into the sector that was beginning to warm up, right? Mm-hmm. And so we started, you know, it was clear that our allocation was going to get smaller and smaller in this investment.
Right.
And one of the things Nick said is, he said, you know, what's really interesting about this company is that what the company has an alternative cryptocurrency, and they are holding 20 million units in the company. Mm-hmm. And yet all the software is, all the technology is open source. So the real value of the company is the currency. Mm-hmm. And so Nick and I sort of looked at each other and looked at Josh and we said, why don't we just buy currency? Mm-hmm. Instead of investing, mm-hmm. just buy the currency. So Nick started buying. Mm-hmm. We didn't buy a lot. It's now worth about 6x what it was.
Wow.
So I think Nick managed to get like 10 grand. So we started, and interestingly, I think Nick said we appeared in like we're like top 50 holder of currency for this, and it's one of the big ones. And so it's still a very raw, wild market out there. Mm-hmm. But you know, it's I'm fascinated by it. Mm-hmm. It's not something we'll do a lot of at Betaworks in terms of the actual. We're going to be more interested in the consumer facing windows into the currencies, and then how we can use the currencies to like let people, you know, tip on Digg, the way they're starting to do on Reddit, or pay for, you know, a tapestry that is not entirely open or something, you know.
Yeah.
So that kind of stuff, I mean, payments, right? Small, anonymous micropayments.
I mean, there's a lot of people, particularly in my profession, who believe like the horse has already left the barn on models in the internet. People are used to paying nothing, used to getting everything for free. And if you try to, you know, say in the media, put up a paywall or, you know, introduce micropayments, other people will just, you know, do stuff for free. Do you, I mean, we talked about how it's disappointing that it developed that way, but do you think it's too late for it to develop differently?
No, I think that, you know, look at the app world, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right? The app world is, it's an incredible ecosystem, and people are paying there. So I think that, you know, going to your website, and particularly a website that is a recycled version of your, like, existing media property,
mm-hmm.
And saying that people are going to pay for that, stupid idea, right? Mm-hmm. It's just, that ain't going to happen. But thinking about, you know, what you do on that device, on, you know, on the iPhone, on your Android phone, on an iPad, and making an app which is a native experience for that device, and that, you know, happens to be either have in-app purchases or something, sure, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think it is you know, the pony or the horse has left the barn in the web browser in that frame, but the web is now so much bigger than that, right? And it's only getting bigger, right? And, you know, as we start to move beyond the phone and beyond the iPad, and, you know, so I think there's going to be more opportunities to architect that, and I think that Apple, you know, have, with the App Store, have done a phenomenal job of that.
But even with the App Store, I mean, you saw in the first year or so of it, most people were charging for apps, and there was this sort of understanding of, you know, you're going to pay $1.99, and Apple already has your information, so there's not this sort of these friction points that there were on the web. And it was almost sort of like this web do-over. And then, you know, pretty rapidly people started giving away apps for free. And then it became, no, apps have to be free. So is it in-app purchases, that's where it's going to go? Or do you think you can build a big consumer company charging for an app?
I mean, I think that there's, you know, there's great examples of huge consumer companies, particularly in the gaming sector. That are either paid or in-app purchases.
Mm-hmm.
And so it depends on the kind of app. I think you've got to, you know, again, taking your, like, you know, I don't know, let's pick on a magazine. You know, taking your magazine and just storing that into an app and expecting that people are going to pay for that, that's not a good idea. If you could turn it into something that actually becomes valuable mm-hmm. in that medium, on that platform, you know, the in-app purchase, you know, is a wonderful sort of freemium alternative.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it took Apple a long time to get there, right? I mean, it's like the in-app purchase stuff and the subscription stuff, you know, with newsstands, they're still like futzing around with. Mm-hmm. And so I still think it's got a long way to go. I think the newsstand is hugely constraining. So there's a lot to be fixed there. But I think you can. I mean, you know, there are big businesses that have been built there.
Right. So going back to your rainforest analogy, do you think that we can get more to a place where there are sort of those trees somewhere in the middle, where you build, you know, a big company that can get, everyone can make a lot of money from, can employ a lot of people, can be sustainable and not just take over fodder, that, you know, has you know, 10, 20 million people who rabidly love that, but never going to get to 100 million, never going to get to a billion?
I mean, I think that the, it's interesting the way you're framing this, because you're trying, I mean, I think what we're trying to do at Betaworks is fill out that, is have things across the whole spectrum. Right, so I love having some things which are in that middle that you're very concentrated on right now. Mm-hmm. Having some really tall things too, but having things across that whole spectrum, I think that that's the, so it's not just building out the middle, and it's not just doing the monoculture thing, it's really trying to build out the spectrum and a collection of things. And so, you know, I mean, it was a privilege to, you know, to be an investor in Tumblr, which I think is a good example of something that went all the way up, right? Mm-hmm. Great New York company. You know, we were, I met David in April of 2007, and, you know, talked to him, this is pre-Betaworks, right? We were just beginning to sort of cook up the Betaworks concept. Committed to an investment round when I met him in April. And then slowly, you know, in the fall, it started to come together. Spark led it, USV jumped in. Mm-hmm. But that was our first investment at Betaworks. And and that was certainly something which went to, you know, the canopy. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's having the diversity. Mm-hmm.
That sounds like you're describing a portfolio approach. And I've read that, like, you don't think of this as a portfolio approach.
I mean, I think about it as a connected system, right? And I think about it as a system where we have a lot of infrastructure at Betaworks. Infrastructure sounds really heavy, like a lot of people. We have a lot of data at Betaworks. We have a core team at Betaworks. We have the ability to be able to take something and test and trial it very fast, cheaply. And then if it's working, begin to grow it up also fairly fast and cheaply, right? And if you're thinking about a world, right, think about the world which we live in and where we're moving with crowdfunding and everything, right? You've got, you know, capital is freely available and widely available. So you've got a drop in the cost of capital. You've got a drop in the cost of development. It's very cheap and easy to develop. And so, you know, what we're going to see and started to see in the last few years is just an incredible crop of things, you know, coming out and of innovation happening, you know, to go back to the rainforest at the ground level, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think that the, I think about what we're doing at Betaworks is creating a way to be able to, with this sort of studio approach, to be able to give a platform where we can grow things faster, better, cheaper, and give them an advantage which they wouldn't have if they were outside in the rainforest on their own. And so it's, you know, it's funny. It is, what we do is different, and but it's been done before in other sectors, right? And so a couple of weeks ago, Bob Weinstein from Miramax and Weinstein Company, right, came by to see us, and he's a fascinating guy. And so, first of all, he knows nothing about the web, right? Like nothing, right? I mean, and he's an amazing film guy, but he's like one of these people who's just complete domain expertise, which I love. I mean, he asked me at one point, as he said, so let me understand this. If you want to put up a website, you don't have to pay anybody to put up that website, right? In other words, there's no gatekeeper.
Right.
Right, because his business is all about distribution and gatekeepers. And he was like, wow. And this was 2013. I'm like, wow, I haven't had one of those conversations in a while. but he's a phenomenally smart guy in his domain. Now, he understood Betaworks in 5 minutes. Because he's like, you're doing the same thing that we did at Miramax. And he's like, you have a platform, you make your own, you know, we made movies, you make websites, they all have a similar genre, you invest in other people's web stuff, it is a similar genre. We invest in other people's movies. You do it all under one roof. That's what Harvey and Bob built. And he said to me, you know, a lot of people have told me they're building Miramax. He said, you're doing exactly that. And so I think that there are analogs, you know, Liberty Media is certainly an analog in the cable business. You know, when I started out, when we started out 5.5 years ago, I looked at, there's some really good analogs in the in biotech, but I forgot their names. It was like a long time ago, but I remember spending like a day researching them. The biotech guys, if I remember right, what they did was that they usually had patents at the holding companies, and they would then license the patents down to the subs. And so there were, you know, I mean, it was one of the core questions you want to ask is sort of what are the assets that you have at the holding company that give the underlying companies a better position in the market, right? Give them an unfair advantage, get them to scale faster, better, cheaper, right? And so in the biotech model, there was a patent licensing arrangement. Which
I think also clinical trials. I mean, there's a lot of younger companies who sell the licenses up so that they don't have to consume the cost of doing that.
Yeah.
So what are they in your case?
So in our case, I mean, we definitely have, I would start first and foremost with people, right? I mean, we have a phenomenal team of people across Betaworks, the studio, and the network of companies that we've invested in. And, you know, people change everything, right? I mean, about 2 years ago, I made some big changes at Betaworks, and we started to build a team, and really build the team. And it's, you know, I've been for years telling entrepreneurs, you know, people are the most important thing, and you got to build, you know, it's like your bench strength. It's true. I did not. I remember. I believed it, but you know how you say things, you believe them, but you haven't like fully experienced them.
Right.
And they haven't like fully like changed the way you think. Mm-hmm. And it is so true.
I want to talk about the Digg acquisition because, you know, you guys are trying to do something that no one, with the exception of, you know, maybe Priceline and eBay, have really done well, which is revitalized sort of a dying, once powerful brand. I think the question that I always have whenever people come in and try to like revitalize MySpace, or people were trying to revitalize Friendster, you see this over and over again, is people will always say, well, there's still a big audience who comes to this site. But how do you know that that's a valuable audience? And is that audience and that brand, you know, are eyeballs sort of always the same value? Because I thought it was interesting. Go ahead.
I mean, it is, you know, I remember about, you know, before Marissa came in, about a year and a half ago, there was something I saw where there was somebody from Yahoo was on some discussion like this, and they was, you know, talking about numbers and some of the Yahoo numbers, and the numbers are astounding, right? I mean, Yahoo is incredible reach, but the interviewer was like, really? You know, because they just don't see it, right? They don't see it in their everyday workflow. And so Digg, right? And Digg numbers, and how we think about, how we thought about Digg. So I think that the, when we acquired Digg, they said, Google Analytics said, it wasn't like the team at Digg said anything that wasn't true. Google Analytics said that there was, I've forgotten, there was 10 to 12 million uniques that was coming through there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, what we did with Digg was we, so Digg got, there was a transition here, and I don't know if I got the narrative exactly right, because I don't really care that much. It was before us, but there was, the Washington Post was interested, I think, in buying the whole company, and then they decided just buy the team, and then LinkedIn bought some patents, and then we found the opportunity. And, you know, technically, the, you know, Digg was being run on pretty much life support, right? Uh-huh. There was a couple of contractors that stayed from the Washington Post who were helping keep it going. And it had a big server infrastructure that it was supporting and that was costing about $200,000 to $220,000 a month. Mm-hmm. And they had this bizarre ad deal with AOL where they would make $230,000 a month. Mm-hmm. And so we looked at that and we said a couple of things. So we said, first of all, is that we were building something in the news space called News On Me, and we had a really nice start to a product. But I think in the news space, it's really hard to break through, right? And I thought Digg was, and is, a phenomenal brand. And it was a brand that hadn't become mud, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like, I think MySpace turned into like mush, right? I don't think in people's eyes they knew what it was any longer.
Uh-huh.
Right? Because it sort of went from being a music site to nowhere social network, because that was kind of what they needed to do to pretend they were going to be like Facebook. And they had this whole expansive view. And people, you know, one of the things that happens with these companies, they become just incredibly broad in their definition of self, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think Digg still had a fairly tightly constrained, you know, view. Social news, right? What the internet's talking about right now. So that was one thing. Second thing is that we said we need to put it onto a 2012 stack, right? We need to put it onto a stack that we can innovate off and that we can grow off, because the technology, I'm sure, was great technology, but some of it probably wasn't. And some of it was just old, right? And so so what we did was we said to the Digg board, we'd love to acquire it. You know, I said to the team and to Kevin, this is, you know, this would be a privilege to take this over and run it. But we're gonna rebuild Digg in 6 weeks. And on August 1st, which is literally when, like, I wish I had a picture of it, but the liquidators came in to like take the servers away.
Right?
Uh-huh. So it wasn't gonna be pretty what happened if, you know, we didn't turn something else new on. So I said on August 1st, we will flip the switch and there'll be a new Digg.
Uh-huh.
And we'll repoint the domain and we'll rebuild the whole thing underneath that. And so we did it. And you know, when we, you know, by September 1st and after a month, you know, we looked at our costs, and you know, the hosting cost was about $18,000.
Uh-huh. So it went down from like $200,000 to $18,000.
$220,000 to $18,000.
Wow.
And that is the, you know, that sort of 12x. That's the industry, right? It's Amazon. It's the whole stack changing. It's the open source stack. It's everything. So we're good at what we do at Betaworks, but there's nothing, you know, it's I expected that. Mm-hmm. And we, you know, we thought it would. And so now we have a stack we can innovate off, right? We can grow off and we can build from. So that's what happened. Does that answer the question?
It does. Why couldn't Digg do that themselves? Because it seemed that they had this ad deal and that was kind of bringing them at stasis. If they could have cut their expenses by $200,000 a month, that would have been a much better situation.
You know, I don't know. I can't speak for them, but I will say is that I'll say two comments, and I'll say it from my experience at AOL, is that, you know, when you've got sort of like, let's use junkie analogies, like when you've got, you know, that in your veins, it's very hard to pull the needle out,
mm-hmm.
right? So you've got a revenue stream from the existing advertising relation business that you've built, you know, and in AOL's case, an access business that you've built over years, have been core of your business, and yet, how do you pull that needle out? It's very, very hard.
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard to do. It's hard for investors. It's hard for everybody involved. I mean, as I said to the Digg team, you're going back to you, is that you started off with uniques and all users equal, right?
Yeah.
I said to the Digg team, as I said, we're going to drop this puppy off the roof and we'll see how high it bounces. In terms of like, we'll see, like in terms of uniques, you know, where it comes back.
Uh-huh.
And those will be real uniques.
Right.
Right? Because the audience that we're building back at Digg now, and you know, the fact that you know, Digg is now, you know, within the BuzzFeed network, it's a bigger referrer than LinkedIn or than Pinterest or than Google Plus,
mm-hmm.
Is because it's real traffic. And the reason why I use the refer data is that's people going to Digg, finding a story that's interesting, and then clicking through it. mm-hmm. right? And so that's why that's important to me, because that is people using the product and clicking through it. Mm-hmm. And so it's not, you know, people using it for SEM purposes. It's not people sort of bending and twisting Digg for their own purposes. They're going to, you know, the BuzzFeed network is a good sort of, you know, proxy for sort of the content world out there.
Right. It's interesting. I think you guys did a survey of Digg readers right when you bought the property to kind of see where
Digg
things
user,
were.
Sorry,
Digg users. Yeah. And it, I'm going to get sort of the numbers wrong, but I remember directionally it was one of these things where it was like, would you recommend Digg to a friend? And like 80% of people said no.
I think it was more than that. I don't know if Jake's... Yeah, but it was, yeah. It's, yeah, yeah.
I think I'm being,
I think it was 95.
Conservative.
Yeah,
and it's like, what were they doing there every day?
Yeah.
I mean, there's this amazing inertia to the web that I don't understand. Yeah. Like, who are the people that go to a site that they hate and wouldn't recommend to a friend every day? Because in the early days of the web, we all thought, oh, well, it's so easy to click in and out of these things. There will be no loyalty in the web. There will be no loyalty in e-commerce the way there is in the physical world. There won't be loyalty in terms of news brands. Like, we'll no longer have this stickiness because you're not locked into things because moving is so easy. And yet, we see a brand like Digg that 95% of people would not recommend to a friend, and they're still going.
And they're still going every day themselves, right?
Like, what's going on with that?
I think that they were. I think that they were quietly hoping that one day they would go and it would have changed, and maybe we made them happy. No, I think that there was. Look, human beings. The web has its structure, but we're human, right? And we have habits, mm-hmm. right? The way we dress, the food we eat, our preferences, the people, we have habits. They're not all logical, they're not all rational, but that's what makes us human and interesting. And so I think that, you know, there was still, I talked about the Digg brand before, and I hate using the term brand or talking about the Digg brand, because the word brand sounds like this abstract. People loved Digg, right? They loved it. It's like when Marco emailed us about Instapaper, it made me happy for a lot of reasons, but one of it is that there aren't any Instapaper users. They are Instapaper lovers. Mm-hmm. They are passionately engaged with that product. They use it many, many times a day. Mm-hmm. You know, take another very different thing which we invested in or bought a large piece of, and we actually moved from Sweden to New York because we loved it so much. It's something called Blog Loving, mm-hmm. which is a fashion blogging network, right? Which is, it's different. It's different from what this audience look at. It's like 90% women. Most of this audience is not women. Mm-hmm. It is, it's got about 7 million uniques who go through it. Last month, it did about 100 million page views, so it's of a reasonable scale. But people love it. Right, and they go, the MAUs over DAUs are blog loving. When they first told me them, these were a group of guys in Sweden, I said to the team, I said, they don't know what they're talking about. Those numbers are wrong, because the MAUs over DAUs were about 50%, mm-hmm. right? And that's sort of where Facebook is. It's higher than Tumblr, right? And so we said to them, I said, do you mind if we put Chartbeat on the site for a couple of months and we'll let you have a free account at Chartbeat? I wanted to see the numbers, right? And see if they footed.
Uh-huh.
And they did. So people love blog loving, they love Instapaper, they love Digg, mm-hmm. right? It's that, and it's that love for the, you know, for what, for the promise of what was, right? For the community, for what, you know, for what Digg represented. That is what, you know, our job is to build around that, because that's precious.
Uh-huh. You know, it's interesting, when we interviewed Brian Chesky in January, he talked a lot about love and the importance of love in a site, and how if you just had people who loved your site, and, you know, didn't matter how many people, if they really loved it, you could build a business around that. And I remember as he was talking, thinking, well, this is easy for you to say because you've had this, you know, runaway growth. You've not had any trouble since the Y Combinator days of having to raise money for this thing and raising money at huge valuations. It's easy for you to say because you have both. You have mass and you have love.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, I don't think someone who goes into a venture capitalist and they're like, well, we don't have a lot of scale, but we have a lot of love.
Yeah.
I don't think they're getting funded.
Well, they should. I think that's true, but there are there are venture capitalists who understand that, right? Fred understands that. I think that there are particularly venture capitalists who've been operators, but people who are builders and people who are users, mm-hmm. right? And who they see that, and so I think it's. There are many of VC who wouldn't and who don't, mm-hmm. But there are some who do, and those are the ones which you should focus on, mm-hmm. because they understand what you're trying to build and they understand your community.
Is there a critical mass of love that you need to be a sustainable business? I mean, because there's probably 5 people who love MySpace still. Like, there's still love somewhere for everyone.
Did you see Rupert Murdoch tweeting about MySpace the other day?
I didn't.
It was fascinating. I think I retweeted it, but he said something like, it was so weird because he was, you know, I love the fact, he actually writes his tweets, right?
Clearly.
He clearly writes his tweets.
That's not a PR person.
And it's like for so many years, I mean, they've kept the veneer, yeah, and it's, but it's broken through.
Uh-huh.
That's the command line, right? That's what I love, the rawness
right.
of that, right? He just like motors through that. Yeah, so he wrote this tweet which said, you know, noticed a decline in Facebook's engagement numbers. I think you mentioned hours or usage per user was going down. And he said, first sign of danger, I know from that piece of crap, MySpace.
Wow.
Well, that crappy MySpace thing. Something crap was in there. And I was like, how much love do you need? Look, you start off with, let me answer the question differently, is that I think if you got something that people love, you can begin to, you got a feature or a product and you can begin to build around that, right? And you can begin to turn that into a business, mm-hmm. right? You can then grow that out. As you grow that out, the reason why I advise entrepreneurs to figure out their business model sooner rather later is that I think it's very important to like figure out, to right size your business. It goes back to the size of the trees, right?
Uh-huh.
And to understand where it is mm-hmm. in the scale, right? Because to understand so that you don't end up distorting your business
right.
via the business model, right? Business models should ultimately, all too often business models are taxes on a business. Well, they're taxes on the user flow inside the product.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion, they should be neutral, or if possible, they should be positive, right? The reason why Google's business model is so astoundingly strong, that one business model, is because it moves with the grain of the workflow,
mm-hmm.
right? I mean, I remember we did testing and you know, people indistinguish the right-hand side from the left-hand side of search results, most mm-hmm. people, and the you know, Google spent billions of dollars perfecting the right-hand side. We always talk about how good search is. You spent a lot of money and invested a lot making the ads really good,
mm-hmm.
right? So that whatever you searched, you get something of value. So if you can figure out something that moves with the grain of the product, sort of, you know, right-size it or like, you know, figure out the correct size for it and then see if you can get a business model. And the business model thing shouldn't be a, like, I hate when it's a product problem,
mm-hmm.
right? It's part of the product.
Right.
It shouldn't be like, oh, we need to bring in those people to figure out the business thing, right? And so it shouldn't be like this external event that happens outside of the flow of the love, right?
Mm-hmm.
It should be you know, the people who built the product who are saying, okay, now we've got another problem. We're going to try and figure out how to build a business around this.
Mm-hmm. So is it okay?
Ideal state, right? I mean, this is
right.
an ideal state. This is hard to do.
Well, I mean, yeah, it is hard to do. And there's certainly a lot of people who say that. I mean, that's what Twitter always said. That's what Evan always said about Twitter. That's what, you know, Facebook said, you know, in a particular time. And like, you can, I mean, I don't know how great the user experience is with, you know, supportive tweets, but I would think most people think on Facebook, the ads are interrupting them. And I'm sure that was not Mark's ideal, but.
And the ads are awful, right? I don't understand why they're so poorly targeted. I mean, they have incredible data there.
Yeah, well, I mean, understand. That was always supposed to be the promise of Facebook, that it was this great holy grail of knowing everything about people and targeting well.
Yeah, I'm fascinated by graph search and, you know, how that rolls out. Because, you know, some of the initial reviews that, you know, and things that I've heard from that are exposing just how limited the data set. I mean, I think that Facebook did a few things on the data side that I think are, maybe it had to do in terms of its business model, but I think that there were some shortcuts that they took that I wonder if they're now paying the price for. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think one was is that they started very early on by trying to impose structured data sets over the friend graph, mm-hmm. right? So you remember, like, right at the beginning, whenever you would friend somebody or somebody would friend you, you would get a friend request, you'd be asked to put, like, in one of five buckets.
Right.
They were trying to, like, structure the data. And, mm-hmm. you know, I would sit there as a user and say, I don't know, they're not a work colleague, I wasn't at college with them, what are they, right? And I'm just like, get out of my face. It's right. Like, I don't want to put somebody into one of these buckets. And so they wanted to structure all the data, which I think is a very convenient way of solving a computer science problem, mm-hmm. but you're reducing human beings down to a very crude set of categories.
Uh-huh.
And then when you try and, I think that what's amazing about Google's model is there's a lot of nuance in there, right? Then I think another thing that happened with Facebook is the like system, which again was a very binary.
Yeah.
Like, do I really like, you know, Holden Spring Water? Well, kind of, but do I really want to, I mean, and then they had advertisers who paid people to like stuff. Mm-hmm. So they kind of like, in the same way that Twitter sort of distorted, there was a lot of, you know, if you remember it, a lot of hoopla about the Twitter promoted friends.
Mm-hmm.
You remember,
yeah.
like right at the beginning?
Yeah.
What the hell was that called? But in the same way, they distorted the graph,
yeah.
the like graph, because people were paying in to get, you know, hundreds, if not hundreds of thousands of likes, companies were. And so I think that there's, you know, I'm really interested in seeing how graph search, you know, comes out, because I think that it's going to expose a lot of the flavor of the data underneath Facebook.
Uh-huh. Interesting. Well, Twitter is a company that you're much closer to. What do you think are the big mistakes Twitter made?
You know, I love Twitter, and I think that, I mean, I think that Twitter has done, you know, first and foremost, you know, if you want to, I mean, they've done a phenomenal job of just growing up the company. And so, and that's really hard to do.
Mm-hmm.
It's always easy to talk about mistakes, but it's just, that is very hard to do. You know, I was on the other side of the ecosystem debate.
Uh-huh.
Meaning that I disagreed.
Mm-hmm.
I still disagree, but I understand the logic of everything they did. And I think going back to your point, I think that, I mean, we were, you know, we had, you know, starting with our work with Surmise, and then when Twitter acquired Surmise, with the work with Bitly and the work which we did with, you know, TweetDeck and TwitterFeed, we were like, you know, in a lot of spaces in the Twitter ecosystem.
Uh-huh.
And the reason was is that I thought it was genius, right? And and I think that for them it was a bug.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that a big piece of that was when they made the definitive decision to monetize through advertising, then I was like, okay, now I can see the tide is going to turn.
Uh-huh.
Right? Because you could just see that's like one of those domino decisions that, okay, you're going to monetize through advertising, therefore you need people looking at your client.
Right.
Therefore the client ecosystem has to go away.
Uh-huh.
Will be minimized. Because unless you're going to monetize through the client ecosystem and then share like 50 cents on the dollar with the client ecosystem, you know, that's not a rational choice that most companies will make. And so the moment they made that decision, I think that they changed the architecture of Twitter. Mm-hmm. Now that said, they've kept it, it's still pretty darn open.
Uh-huh.
And so, I mean, I think that they've sometimes conflicted internally, but there's a lot of wonderful things that they've done. But on the ecosystem debate, I love the diversity of it, right? I love the diversity of the interfaces.
Right. You could experience it so many different ways.
You want to use Tweetbot, I want to use TweetDeck, go at it, right? Mm-hmm. It's just like, it was, you know, it was brilliant that, you know, the design decision, you know, that's, you know, going back to the web as, you know, this big data set, is that there's a tight coupling that normally happens between people's data set and between the interface, right? Mm-hmm. And decoupling that and through an API, and so, you know, people can all use different flavors, gives you so many more use cases for the product, right? It makes the product, you know, so much more flexible.
Right.
Whether it goes into SMS or whether it goes into, it's just like, it turns the product into a weed and it looks more like, it looks a little bit more like email. But the challenges of monetizing that are different. So I think that raising all the money and then deciding on that it was going to be an ad model, kind of like that sort of costs the future for me.
When do you see that decision of becoming an ad model taking place? Because some people might say if you start a company and you're not charging, you're effectively opting into the ad model because there's just not a lot else. I mean, did Twitter have another choice?
Well, I think that it goes also to, I agree with most of what you said, but I would also say that I think that the ad model is much richer than a simple, survey unit of negative attention, right? It's like going back to Google, it's like that's a more of a direct marketing model, but it's ads that work for people, right?
Uh-huh.
And so is the, you know, so I think that there's more diversity in the ad model than people normally have, or normally imply, and then I think that there's more to be done on the paid side.
Mm-hmm. I want to get back to a little bit more of the history of Betaworks because we sort of got into these bigger issues and
less kind of
your
like,
story.
Yeah.
So, you know, you talked about all these things, this sort of theory that you had in mind when you wanted to start this. And then, you know, but you've always had this mix of how much you're investing out in things, how much you're developing things in-house, do you spin things out? How has all of that evolved in time? And do you back different kinds of projects based on which one of those it's following? Does one give you more freedom than the other? Are there ones where you figured this is just corrosive to the spirit of what we're trying to do? How did the way you go about funding and building and discovering and creating all these things you want to have in this rainforest, the way you were going about doing it change or need to change?
How did it need to change? Let me try and answer it, and you tell me if I'm answering it. I don't think it's changed that much. We've gone through there was like a first chapter of Betaworks, which I, you know, the first 3.5 years, and then sort of a second chapter, which we started about 1.5 years ago. And in the second chapter, you know, we had done well, so we had some options to be able to do things that we couldn't do before. But if you go back to the original business plan, many of those things, you know, when we sat around the table, you know, right in the early days with the core team, with Andy and with Billy and with Neil, we talked about, you know, that we wanted to do some things that we're now doing, right? We talked, mm-hmm. Even back then, we talked about Digg. We talked about right at the beginning about URL shortening and tiny URL. And, you know, we talked about data and APIs and, you know, many of the seeds were there, but it's evolved. It is, you know, what we do is on one hand is we're very thoughtful and, but on the other hand, we're very, I hope we're attentive to the environment and we see things and we jump from here to here, very fast.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I wouldn't say the Digg opportunity was absolutely right for us to do. We had no idea it was out there until, you know, Brett Burlington, you know, gave us a shout and said, hey, there's this curious situation we're in. Do you want to chat?
Mm-hmm.
And so it's, part of it is strategic and part of it's highly organic, right?
Uh-huh. It sounds like with both Digg and Instagram, people kind of reached out to you guys.
Instapaper.
I'm sorry, Instapaper. Yeah, Instagram you do not own,
yeah,
just to be absolutely clear.
Yeah.
With both of those, they...
A little bit more expensive.
Right, or they're slightly more expensive. They probably could have cut you a deal. You're a nice guy. Yeah. You've got a nice accent.
A lot of love there, too. Yeah.
With both Instapaper and Digg, two of the things that people might know you most for, people reached out to you. Do you think you're known as sort of this home for misfit toys?
No, I mean, look, when they reached out to us for Digg, we had no home for misfit toys, right?
Right.
We had never done that before. And so, I mean, I think that the...
Brett was just going down the phone book and he got to you.
No.
Hey, do you want Digg?
It's a very short phone book, right? Because who else are you going to call, right? I mean, it is sincerely, right? It's like there aren't many other sort of development studios of this kind that you could like pick up a phone and call, right? And you know, Digg, I don't want to speak for them, but I'm certain that they had spoken to all the big guys, right?
Mm-hmm.
Through their journey.
Mm-hmm.
And so there aren't many other places. And so I think that this, the studio model is, and certainly with Marco. Look, Marco, I mean, he wrote me this, this email at 2:30 in the morning saying I'm lying here in bed, and I'm just trying to figure out what to do with Instapaper, and how to grow it up. And I'm making $1 million a year after Apple's cut, and so that's good. I don't want to hire a team.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to take funding. And it suddenly hit me, is the place this should be is at Betaworks.
Mm-hmm.
And so, we sat down with Marco, but, I think that he, first and foremost, I appreciated his trust. But I think that he sat there and said, okay, it needs to be an environment where it's going to grow up and have a team and grow in the context of an ecosystem.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Marco was always, Instapaper was always heavily connected into its, it had a great API, it had a whole bunch of partnerships, right? It had a whole laundry list of services that it worked with. So he already had the same ethos, right?
Right.
So I think he suddenly said, oh wait, I can see where this fits.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's, those, you call them misfit toys or whatever you said, but. People love them, and we certainly do, yeah.
There are these things that are either sort of diminished brands or, the derogatory word in the venture business, lifestyle businesses, things that make money and are profitable but can't grow, that don't have much of a home. Do you want to be the repository of more of that? Do you, go around looking at things and you're like, oh, that's a diminished brand. I can turn that one around.
Yeah, no. Yeah. Hulu?
You want Hulu? What would you do with Hulu?
I don't know really what I would do with Hulu. I don't, that one I'm a little bit, I wouldn't say confused by, I just think the rights issues are where that whole thing comes unstuck or unraveled. So we'll see what happens. But, we spend most, practically all of our time at Betaworks building stuff we want to build. And the other stuff is sort of circumstance driven.
Uh-huh.
And so, It's not out, like we're out there saying, are we going after this diminished brand? I think that part of the challenge with Digg, which I loved, was just what you said, is that there aren't many people who've done that, right? And who've revitalized something.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's a really hard and interesting problem. And I wonder if we could do that. So we love hard problems. We love doing things that other people aren't doing. We love doing things that people say, are you crazy? Why would you do that? But but we're not sitting around saying, however you call them.
You're not looking at the web and looking at falling Alexa graphs and thinking, that's the one I'm going to snap up next.
Alexa, that's a good one.
What would you do with them? That's a lot of data.
Yeah, well, they could have good data for a start. That's like such bad data. It is just like, it's such bad data. Can I get a beer?
Yeah, absolutely. Can someone get John a beer?
Thank you.
What about, where have you had the best track record? Investing, building, buying? Because it seems like investing, you had a lot of big hits early on that sort of proved the model, so you had more freedom.
Yeah, the most successful stuff that we've done at Betaworks financially has been the stuff that we've played a role in building and developing. Mm-hmm. And so the investments, I mean, the pure investments, we did this analysis of just looking at the investments because we'd done, I think, like 71 of them, and we just said, let's just look at them as pure investments, because the investing activity at Betaworks is it's so central to what we do at Betaworks, but it sits around the core of what the studio built, mm-hmm. right? But we looked at that as sort of in an isolated or sort of just as a pure mark to market and what we do, and we're at about 5.7x on that, which is me, thank you. Which is good. Mm-hmm. So I think we're in the upper, sort of reaches of where a seed fund would be if that's what you want to analyze this as. But we're not that, right? And I think the reason why we're really good at it is because we're not that. Uh-huh. Because we're fundamentally builders, we're makers, we have a different relationship to the entrepreneurs and so on. Mm-hmm. But most of the biggest returns that we've had have been related to things that we've built.
We've had a lot of conversations on this stage with people from Josh Koppelman, Ben Horowitz, Fred Wilson, all sorts of about where venture capital is going. Naval from AngelList was a big one. And a lot of people have had sort of bold visions on that. I mean, some people think it needs to be more service-oriented. Josh Koppelman's trying to build it into something that's more scalable and product-based. Fred Wilson thinks that discovering things is going to be separated from, sort of the asset management piece of it. I'm curious, do you think that you guys are emblematic of where venture capital goes, or do you think you are like just a weird outlier and
no,
that
I
it
think
goes
that
in
we're,
another direction?
Look, I think like we touched on this briefly earlier, is I think that you've just got more diversity in the system, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think we're a model which you're going to see more of, but you're going to see it alongside other people. And so it's just it's a different model, but it certainly can scale. You can build a big company this way, and you'll see other people do it, and you'll see other people continue to do what we call venture capital today. I think that that business, which I'm not a VC, so I don't pretend to know that much about, but I think that there's a lot of tension in that business. And I think it comes from a lot of different angles. One thing which I've always thought is really weird and interesting about that business is it is because of the life cycle of funds. Everybody keeps predicting. I mean, there has been an incredible culling of funds, but ever since I've been in the business, people have been predicting that it's going away.
Right.
And it ain't, mm-hmm. right? Or it hasn't, yeah. Mm-hmm. The second thing which I find fascinating about it is just what incredible returns there is to the very small number of people at top.
Right.
Right? And so it really is it's a pretty shitty asset class on the average, but it's a phenomenal asset class in a few cases. And so that I think is interesting. I think the amount of time that capital's locked up in the funds is going to change. Uh-huh. I think that capital is, and investors are getting more sophisticated. You're seeing investors, sort of normal investors in venture funds, put together these special purpose vehicles and come into Pinterest, when it's worth a couple of billion. Independent of their VC investments. So you're seeing investors go direct. Uh-huh. You're seeing Naval and AngelList come up from the bottom, which I think is hugely disruptive and interesting. Then you have all the crowdfunding stuff that's happening. So I think the whole market is shifting around this model. And I think it begs for innovation.
Right.
Right. And so, I mean, we don't sit there and say, how can we innovate financially? Because that's not the way we think. We're engineers, but not that kind of engineers, right? But it does beg for innovation, and we have taken a different model. The model we've taken is so intuitive to me, right? I mean, I remember I did this fireside chat with Kevin Rose about 2 years ago on Foundation, and when he was running Milk. Mm-hmm. right? And we talked about the investing side, and Kevin was like, I can see why you do so many things, but the investing, you know, why do you do the investing? And I said, Kevin, you invest personally.
Yeah.
Right? And we talked about why he did that. And he does it, certainly he wants to make money, but he also does it because it gives him, there's second order effects to the investment in terms of just understanding the market, keeping yourself alive to the innovation that's out there, understanding what's happening around the spaces that you're building. And you have entrepreneurs who are doing that personally. And we just do it at Betaworks. We just do it, you know, off our balance sheet, which is a little bit, it's architecturally different, right? But it is, when people hear it that way, they're like, okay, now I understand it, right? And so I think that, I mean, the model to me is so intuitive. It just makes sense, right? And my very first company, right, we hopscotched. You tried to like get a linear narrative, you know, from...
You refused.
Yeah.
I gave up.
Yeah. And so we just hopscotched around. But, you know, my first company, which you know, was, you know, when I started Betaworks, my wife said to me, this is the same thing you did in 94.
Yeah.
Right? My first company was, we started with one site and then we built another site. I should talk about what they were, because they were pretty great. But, and then we had an umbrella on top that was called Web Partners. Mm-hmm. And we raised capital into that, you know? And so this studio kind of model has, you know, sort of been in, I don't know, it's, for me, it's in my bones and it makes sense and it works for the way I think and the way I do things.
Mm-hmm. I want to talk a little bit about gaming because you guys were investors in OMG Pop, which was, you know, a big phenomenon and exit and then sort of fell off the map. You have Dots now, which apparently everyone except for me is spending their entire lives doing. I have a 3-month-old, which is why I'm changing diapers instead of playing Dots. I thought we were
going to play. There was somebody who tweeted.
Yeah, I think that was sort of the wish. But
you want to do it?
No. We could have someone from the audience play with you.
I'm not playing against. I would be trounced in five seconds. Yeah, no, I'm not playing against anybody from the audience. I'm not very good, right?
Well, then maybe I would be.
Yeah, I can give you some tips if you'd like.
There, people would love tips.
Yeah, so this is what I've heard, not necessarily what I've experienced, because I'm...
So you cannot vouch for these tips.
No, look, I mean, I love doing things which I've... And speaking from experience, but I mean, I'm in the... I don't know. I've got it on a lot of different phones and a lot of different, but I think I'm in the high 200s, so I'm certainly not a Dots sort of expert. I think I'm like a, I don't know, a yellow belt or something like that. I don't even know a judo belt. I'm like, I'm way down there. Squares, right? You got to do squares. And people, I think sometimes people take a while figuring out, and they want to, there's something very human about like wanting to, like you get a big rectangle and like filling out, just do the square, right? Because you get the same points and it's much faster. So just think squares, 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 squares. Second thing is the, don't be shy about restarting. Mm-hmm. Right? I think that people sort of have this sort of like, well, I started, I should just go through the whole game. Just like restart and just like redo the game. Because you get a board that is working in your favor. It's kind of like one of those days in life that just sort of everything fits.
I'm like seeing an analogy of building web companies here as well.
Yeah, no, it's Dots is a metaphor for Betaworks, right? It's all about connecting the dots, right? And so... you get a board just like you get a day where just everything seems to work, right? And you're just like, so don't feel shy about restarting. The power-ups are really useful, right? And so shrinkers people love, which are the things in the middle. And I think that one of the reasons why the shrinkers are so effective is that you can use them in the game flow. Right, you don't have to leave the game, go to the bottom, you can just double tap, right? So you see something that's almost a square, you double tap and you zap the other thing and then you go square. And then extra time, right, the bottom left, if you've got a good board and a good game going, and you're 50, you know, you got 10 seconds left, just hit that left-hand button and you got some extra time. Mm-hmm. So those are some dots. There you go, Sarah. What was your question?
The phenomenon of dots. Well, I want to talk about there's so much skepticism and sort of bearishness about gaming right now. And I think a lot of it comes from Zynga, which, you know, certainly tied in OMG Pop. Right now you're seeing people are really excited about Candy Crush, but they wonder, is this going to be a downside for King? There's people who feel like Angry Birds, like maybe that's waning. And there's just a lot of sense of, you know, game companies are too hits driven, and you cannot build a venture backable, exitable business around games. I mean, having now profited from a few of these things, which were very hits driven, I'm curious how you think about games and if they're different than other types of things you guys build.
Well, I mean, I think that so I'm not a gaming guy, right? And I think that the reason why we did Dots is partially is because we aren't gaming people. It was different for us. But I think the gaming business and games, similar to music, have always been subject to fads. Mm-hmm. And you know, when you were a kid or when your kid grows up, there's going to be 10 games that he or she will play, and that, you know, so it's always been that way with games. And so I think that, you know, if you're asking the question, should gaming companies be venture funded, should they be public companies, I think that you're coming at it from a sort of capital perspective, uh-huh. right? And I would come at it from a, look, I was in Europe a couple of weeks ago, I met the CEO of Supercell, mm-hmm. right? They're making about $1 million a day. They've raised some venture money, but you know, they've got sort of a studio-like structure. There was this company this week in Boulder who sold to Hasbro, or sold 70% of their company to Hasbro, that is another gaming studio. So there's a bunch of, the gaming studio and the studio structure intrigues me because it's, you know, not dissimilar to what we think about at Betaworks. But I think that the fact that gaming's hit-driven is, it is a hit-driven business. Mm-hmm. Now, so a couple of answers to, you know, the capital question that I can think of off the bat. One is that there's, you know, there's a very good answer, which is most music companies ended up in larger media companies because you can balance the hit-driven aspect of it with other assets.
Right.
Right? So maybe the gaming companies should either not be public companies or they should be mixed in with another set of assets, right? Mm-hmm. In the same way is that you have, like, you have a lot of gaming going on down here in Wall Street, right? Mm-hmm. And most investment banks have mixed that with advisory businesses, mm-hmm. which are sort of more predictable and, you know, sort of have less sort of velocity, you know, to them. And so, you know, I think the idea of mixing a gaming business with another business may be the solution if you're going to be a public company. Mm-hmm. But it is a hit-driven business, right? Mm-hmm. Nobody would deny that, right?
I mean, and do you feel like you guys are riding this wave of dots, but, like, pretty soon no one's going to care? Does that feel inevitable?
I would say a couple. So there are games, I mean, there are iconic games that have persisted. Right, and so you know, if we can, the high bar for us is, can we turn Dots into something that becomes an iconic game? Mm-hmm. Right, and so we're getting about 12 million game plays a day now, which ain't bad. And you know, we are developing it and developing new forms of the gaming and so on. And so if we can turn it into that, then that would be great. The question's totally fair. There's some which just, you know, fly really high and then crash and burn. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, was that Farmville? I'm not sure. I mean, it's like, you know, and could they have done something different there with Farmville? Mm-hmm. Or if Draw Something hadn't been sold to Zynga, would the outcome have been different? Mm-hmm. You know, it's hard to tell.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned both PayPal getting sold and how that limited what PayPal could have become. Possibly Draw Something getting sold, limiting what it could have become, or they could have become as a game studio. What do you think about Tumblr? Company you were involved in early days, many people have said failed to actually really build a business and, you know, I guess monetize sort of all of the promise and what was great about Tumblr. Do you see that as a failure, and do you worry that somehow by selling to Yahoo, it's limiting what it could have become?
Look, I think that, I mean, I think that Yahoo is suddenly a hugely interesting company again, because Marissa is a product person, right? And she's not a manager, she's not a, she's not in the business of sort of constructing leadership. She actually has, she has a product vision, right? And she was willing to go out and do it, an acquisition like Tumblr. I think that I think Tumblr was starting to monetize, and I think if they had stayed independent, I think you would have seen numbers come out of Tumblr, would have been impressive, because I think that, you know, Tumblr does have, there's a lot of page views there. And go back to what we were talking about with Twitter before, and the sort of the pixel problem, right?
Yeah.
So whereas Twitter sort of, you know, when they decided to do advertising, they needed to find that inventory and find all those pixels. And they had a very fast moving stream, and they had a lot of clients. They had a fast moving stream and a distributed set of endpoints, right? Tumblr and David architected beautifully this platform where there was no clients and he had a lot of pixels. And so I think that you know, he was starting to monetize and could have monetized. So I don't see it as a failure of that. I think that the company was was struggling to sort of mature and build out the management team and, you know, get to the next stage. But we've seen many companies who've gone through that. I have high hopes inside of Yahoo. I mean, I hope that it will be like a YouTube-like thing, right? Because I'm, you know, I'm fundamentally an optimist, and I M&A is really hard, and most of it gets fucked up.
Right.
And in most cases, you know, it becomes sort of something that gets sidelined. I think Google did a phenomenal job with YouTube. Was that by architecture? Was that by happenstance that they didn't really get it and they just left it alone? Because they were just like, whatever that YouTube thing.
Right.
I don't know. But it worked there, and I hope we can do more of those. I mean, I think one of the things that's fascinating today, and it sort of goes back to the Betaworks question, was, so you have, so what's Twitter doing with Vine? Right? Okay, so at some sort of, you're in the journalist business, and you're sort of like in the business of trying to connect these dots.
Right.
So at some level, they're trying to like get video-like experiences into Twitter. Right, and you could say, oh, they're trying to do, you know, they didn't get Instagram, they didn't get Instapaper, and so now they want to get a video experience in Twitter.
Right.
And so, okay, that makes sense to me, but it's a different brand.
Yeah.
It's an entirely different thing. So is Twitter now becoming a collection of products? You know, does Facebook, you know, how do these companies grow up? How does innovation, you know, that sort of, that question we started with at the beginning, how does innovation actually get sustained within these companies?
Right.
And then how do the, does Twitter become a platform where they have a monetization platform and they share that across Vine and then they buy four other things and share them across there? And they become, you know, they have much broader reach because of that. It's, you know, something interesting is going on there.
Well, so what about Yahoo, though? Because that's...
What about what?
I mean, Yahoo's an even more extreme example of this. Like, some people look at Betaworks, and they just see a bunch of stuff, and it doesn't make sense to them as a cohesive thing. That's how I feel about Yahoo and the acquisitions that Marissa's making.
Well, I mean, I think that... So you need to have... I think that as a product person, I mean, I think about things... Again, the habitual stuff people use every day. And the core of Yahoo at the beginning was the directory. And then it became email. And if I'd been running Yahoo, I would have threaded more stuff around the directory and email. And I think that, you know, I mean, they did phenomenal acquisitions. You know, Flickr was an amazing company.
Yeah.
Delicious was an amazing company. I mean, but then they kind of like, they... the organization kind of rejected them, or the organism kind of rejected them, and they got kind of like starved for resources and kind of like, well, there was Yahoo Photos still, right?
Right.
And they, I mean, it's like they should have made Flickr, Yahoo Photos. Mm-hmm. And they should have, you know, figured out how to be a multi-brand company, but also threaded into that core experience, which was where most of the traffic was in email, in Yahoo Finance, and those core things. So I think that she's trying to re-architect that. I don't envy her. I mean, it is very hard, I think, to re-architect that from the top down. Mm-hmm. It's much easier and much more fun to architect it like we're doing at Betaworks from the bottom up. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so, you know, because we can make things that they connect, and we can put them together and make them make sense, and we can grow them up, and we can kill things, and we can, you know, just keep, you know, moving very fast through this process. Whereas if you're sitting there at Yahoo, you've got sort of like, you know, you've got all this legacy business, you've got all these legacy business models, you've got a lot of legacy code, and you've got a lot of legacy culture, mm-hmm. that says you can't do that with email, you can't kill Yahoo Photos. Yahoo Photos is so important to somebody, right?
Right.
And you just, you know, but I think as a product person, I think that she has the best chance of making the hard calls. Mm-hmm. Because you've got to make sense of that as a product.
Right.
And it's either a portfolio that has some connective tissue in it, or it is a, or they should just spin them out and shut them down, mm-hmm. which is kind of the approach that AOL's taken, right?
Yeah. So last thing I want to ask you about, and then I want to get some questions from
last
the audience,
thing, right.
Is, you know, let's talk about New York a little bit. And now I've had like endless conversations, both, you know, on stage at TechCrunch and, you know, doing these about, you know, where New York is as an ecosystem and how does it compare and blah, 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 blah. I'm interested in hearing from you because you think about things differently. What do you think people don't understand about the New York ecosystem? What's either overstated or what's understated? But what has made this finally catch fire in a way that a lot of ecosystems in the U.S. want to, but very few do?
Okay. What is not understated? I mean, I think that So I think the New York ecosystem is finally emerging. I think that there's a lot more technology here and love for technology than people actually understand and appreciate. Mm-hmm. Because the scale of media, the scale of finance, all that stuff is so huge in the city that it overshadows what we do. But it also brings diversity to what we do. I mean, I came over here with somebody who's with us for a bit at Betaworks, and who moved in from California, and I asked him, why did he come from California? Mm-hmm. And he said, because I worked out in California. Everywhere I go, when I go out to dinner, when I go out to lunch, people are talking about Python, people are talking about their startup, and in New York, I get to go out and I get to sort of see and feel and experience the world, right? Mm-hmm. And a sense of the world, right? That feeds me, it feeds my brain. I mean, I've had, you know, this discussion with many people out west, and I remember arguing with Reid Hoffman about it. It's like, it's hugely stimulating to me. I would be stifled in Mountain View. Mm-hmm. It's like such an incredibly beautiful part of the world that is like being turned into like these office parks that are just like, it's like barren. It's like so, like, it's so sad. And it's so devoid of culture. It's like, and I think that the web is so much of what we're building today, and what I believe we're building towards, is, you know, about the humanization of technology and about taking this. I mean, we've never before in the history of mankind, womankind, peoplekind, dogkind, anything, we've never before had such a short period of history, of time, where we're re-architecting the way we think and the way that we interact with our environment, right? Mm-hmm. Somebody came by Betaworks yesterday, and they said, oh my God, it's so silent. And everybody's sitting there at Betaworks building stuff, and they're looking at their screens, and their heads are like, you know, their brains are like immersed in this thing, and they've got this crude input device called, you know, a keyboard and a mouse. But their brains are like totally like inside of this world. Mm-hmm. And that's happened in 30 years.
Yeah.
Right? Like we've taken like human creativity and like placed it inside of a network. It's like, it's astounding what we're doing. And there is yet so much of the world that we've built, the physical world that we've built in cities like in New York. And so much of what we built around us, businesses, fashion industry, design industry, tech industry, so on, finance, are the representations of humankind and of human interest. Mm-hmm. And those need to be part of that humanization of technology, needs to be part of how we build what we're building. Mm-hmm. Because we can't like create this world for our children that is one where we've like dumbed down the diversity of our human experiences down to a set of categories that happen to be good for a discrete monetization, you know, tool on a particular website, mm-hmm. right? Not to pick on Facebook, but. So, you know, the world is so much more diverse than that, and humankind is that. And we have to, you know, I think that cities like New York are doing a phenomenal job of that, of bringing that diversity into technology. And they're just different from Silicon Valley, right? It's like, I love Silicon Valley. Every time I go there, I get so excited about the stuff I see, the people I meet, and the quality of people there, and the thinking. But I also, when I get on the plane, come back, I'm like, phew, it's like I digest all of that, but the food for my brain is in the diversity of the culture here. Mm-hmm. Does that answer some of your question?
Yeah.
Let me give you a very different answer, which is one which you probably won't expect, is I think that Bloomberg has done an insanely great job. Mm-hmm. So, and for New York, and for New York tech. So, just to state biases up front, I've had, there's a technology council that I'm part of for the mayor. So I've seen some of it up close. But they've done a really good job of being at times like at staying at the right layer of the stack.
Yeah.
Right. It's like I think it's hugely important that government understand which layer of the stack that they can have an influence at, and then mm-hmm. stay the hell out of the other layers.
Uh-huh.
Right. And they've done a great job. I mean, at certain layers of the stack. Mm-hmm. And they've also done a great job of like. Figuring out what are these sort of the small things that you can do architecturally, because it goes back to Betaworks in some sense, is that all of this is about like how you architect what you do, mm-hmm. what's the intent that you bring to what you build, and how do you set up the house, how do you architect the framework, mm-hmm. right? And I think that Bloomberg and the Bloomberg administration have had a point of view that. It's been fairly distributed. They've accepted input from a lot of different places. They've focused on critical layers of the stack that they can influence. They've stayed out of other layers. They've done some insanely great data projects, mm-hmm. which I think have helped the city in wonderful ways. And I think that they brought more transparency and accountability to the process of city government.
Yeah.
Which has been great. So I think we've been lucky.
Yeah, I've written a lot about how I think the city of San Francisco and Silicon Valley are really always fighting with each other because they're just very, very different ethoses in terms of success and wealth and capitalism and protectionism and all of these issues. And I was struck on Monday, I came in town Sunday night and I turned on sort of CNBC on my hotel Monday, and they had someone on there talking about how, you know, New York is turning all of these abandoned phone booths into hotspots. And I just said, this is just a better city. It is just a better city.
Yeah.
You just cannot argue it.
Right. And I think it's the diversity. It's the diversity of, look, I mean, one of the things, the Bloomberg guys are very analytical when they looked at finance and they said, okay, that's a mature industry. It's a big frigging industry. Let's look at what else there is, right? Mm-hmm. There's technology and there's fashion, right? Mm-hmm. And I know both those industries, my sister-in-law and my brother on the fashion side, so I know that sort of. And they've sort of fed both of those, right, mm-hmm. aggressively. And it's just, you know, I think that they've done a phenomenal job of that. I think the diversity of that is helpful because San Francisco is at some level a company town.
Yeah.
And I think that that concentration actually works against it in some ways, right?
I think people also feel like tech is out of control and needs to be something that's reined in,
right,
versus encouraged.
Right.
All right, well, let's go to some questions from the audience, because I think there's a million things we could talk about with you. You have such a broad portfolio. I'd like to hear what's on other people's mind. And just line up alongside this wall if you have questions. Don't be shy.
Hi, John, how are you?
Thanks for
spending so much time with us. You recently judged the New York City Big Apps competition.
Yep.
So can you just talk about that, kind of just picking up off of those last comments you made about diversity in New York and what maybe Bloomberg's doing, and what excited you about it, and what do you think that can do to help?
So I was, I've been part of the Big Apps competition from the beginning. I've been a judge from the beginning, and we worked with, Challenge Post powered it at the beginning, and then Collab Finder powered it this time, which are both Betaworks companies. So we're sort of tightly embedded in here. That's my sort of disclosures up front. but this year was great. And I think that the apps that came out were great. Look, last year was like, there was like 30% of the apps were, I hope you didn't build one of these. About 30% of the apps were like, they took the data stream for like all the rats at this restaurant. And it was basically the sanitation department on restaurants, and it was just like a different app to like find me the restaurant that has the best sanitation record. And that's nice, but you don't need 30 of them. And this year was much more creative. And it goes back to that architecture point that I was making before, is that we did a meeting with the Bloomberg and his team a couple of weeks ago, and they really understood, let me say something up front somewhat. I think that when they first came into tech, Bloomberg is a technologist, entrepreneur, but he's not really from the internet, right? And when they first came in, it coincided with the re-election, and it was somewhat marketing,
uh-huh,
right? I mean, we've seen politicians come in time and time again and use the internet for fundraising / marketing purposes. And then, once they get elected, they're like, okay, that was useful. Now let me get back to sort of politics as usual. I think the administration, the Bloomberg administration, either understood or they had a hunch that the big apps competition and opening up APIs would increase the availability of data within the city and the accessibility of data within the city. So one of the things that we pushed for, which finally started to happen, was to have read-write APIs. Because at the beginning, the first big apps, it was like, you got a CSV dump, right? It was just basically a big data dump. There wasn't like a continual stream of data. But to have read-write APIs really got you to the point that you could start building interesting things. I think what's great is that you're starting to see the city is using these APIs internally, right? Which is insanely great, right? There's this wonderful story, I'll go through this quickly, but that the city did, they have this internal thing called Data Bridge, which uses the APIs across the 36 or 38 agencies within New York City. And they focused the Data Bridge project on like figuring out fires. And they figured out that the single greatest predictor of a fire in a building was age of the building and materials of the building, right? Building materials, fairly obvious, right? But then they looked at fire inspections, and they realized that one of the single best indicators of whether a building was inspected was there a Costco near the building, which the fire guys could go shopping, or was there a Dunkin' Donuts nearby? And seriously, it's like the fire houses are responsible for inspections. Supposedly they hate inspections. It was all done on car catalog, and inspections were like entirely uncorrelated to places of high incidence. So they used the data to remap that. And fires are way down in New York. It's like
it's awesome, right? But it's so obvious. But it's like, so I think that the, again, going to architecture, right? Because if you change the architecture of a system, then you begin to change all the follow-on effects. So I think big apps is much bigger than the apps. It's like beginning to API, it's beginning to like construct an API for a city.
That's interesting.
And the data for a city, which I think is hugely exciting. Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question? I got to rant a bit.
I'm so jealous of you as a city.
1, 2?
Yeah.
Oh. You should move it.
So yeah, in the last year, you guys have done some interesting stuff with location, like Paperboy acquiring Vibe and investing in Highlight. Where do you see kind of location as, you know, fitting in into your ecosystem as a layer across your existing infrastructure? And where do you see kind of the current analogies, analogs being made and drawn between location in the real world and location-based services?
So, so great question. I'm fascinated by location. And Sarah, you know, failed in like getting the narrative from the beginning. But you know, the second company I started was called Total New York, and it was the one of the first city sites. Right, and so we're talking 94, October 94. And so I've been fascinated by location because, you know, at a very general or sort of an abstract level, when you think about the architecture of the web and you think about like trying to like understand the web, it's like location and mapping are how we understand our world, right? And they're the sort of the construct, the data construct, the map is a data construct we place around our world, right? And so I'm fascinated by that. And I think that ambient location collection services like Highlight are fascinating, right? And I think we are just, I mean, if you haven't met Paul Davidson, he's a great founder entrepreneur. He's thought about this stuff intensely. We are just at the beginning of this, right? And so, you know, as data collection becomes more distributed, as it becomes ambient data collection becomes more widely available through, you know, whether it's Google Glass or wristbands or services like Moves or stuff like that. There's like Moves API is really cool, right? Jacob at Betaworks has done some cool hacking on that. It's like there's like so much stuff which is going to come out of this, you know. There's like retailers who are starting to, I mean, there's serious privacy issues here, but they're starting to look at, you know, most people have their Wi-Fi turned on their phone, right? So I can see your MAC address, and I don't know who you are, but I know that you came to my store yesterday and that you went back to the underwear department 4 times, right? And so, not saying that you did. But it's getting late, so
it's a coincidence, yeah. Though he did actually.
Yeah. So all that data is becoming available, and so you could see. I mean, we're creating this massive data shadow, right, in real space. That I think that, you know, understanding that and understanding it historically, understanding how that, you know, relates to other services, hugely interesting.
Okay.
Paperboy rocks. What is she telling me?
I don't know.
Yes. Be brief. What are you saying?
She wants me not to yell into the mic at you.
Oh, okay. Oh.
Thank you.
I was going to say, John. Don't listen to her.
Yeah.
Hey, John. Yeah.
My name's Andrew. I'm a student at NYU. In your most recent shareholders letter from Betaworks, you talked a lot about contextual web, you know, bringing...
You read that thing?
I read that thing. I read all
good
25
for you.
Pages
I
of
try.
It.
I can't
it was,
get past page
it was
one.
Awesome. It was so... It was
look, I... it's that is an opportunity for me to, like... It's a free flow of ideas. So thank you for reading it. But, yeah. My sympathies.
I thought it was really interesting. The idea of contextual web and bringing services that we look at every day to filtering things from urgent messages, which you talked about a little bit. All the way to just daily routine. You know, do you have any hints on maybe how that will manifest? Where do you see that developing?
Yeah, so I mean, interestingly, it relates to the previous question, right? I mean, it's this massive data shadow and it's all contextual data. I refer to it as contextual computing. I think it's really important the term you use for this stuff, right? And because I think language sort of dictates how you frame things and how you think about them. So I don't, Internet of Things to me is very passive. Contextual is like this dynamic, rich environment. And as I said earlier, is I think that as data moves and it gains context, it gains value in a lot of cases, right? And so, so I think that there's, you know, we're going to see an incredible amount of technology and of software that is going to be built around that, and we're fascinated by that. It's happening. It's happening in an incredibly distributed way. So I believe I've often argued for the physics are on the side of openness. Forget the politics, but I think the physics draw us towards openness. And the physics for me are that, you know, cheers are not banned. Do you not have on your wrist?
Yes, I do.
And, you know, I have, let's say, a Nike Fuel band, and somebody else uses the Moves app. People want that data to interconnect, right? And the Jawbone guys are unlikely to, or the Oakley guys are unlikely to build an end-to-end operating system like Google will. And so they're going to interoperate. The Oakley glasses will come because Google Glass is wonderful, sort of, it's kind of wonderfully interesting, but it's the tech is not that hard, right? But what they will, the Oakley glasses will be interoperable with everything, right? It won't just be Google Plus on there, it will be everything on there, right? So I think the distributed nature of the environment we're building, the data collection environment, is the physics on the side of openness. And that to me is very exciting. Why? Because, I mean, put my politics on the table, I like that. But it also increases diversity. I like it because it increases diversity and it increases our ability to actually create this again in a human way, right? To create these experiences and architect these experiences in a human way. Mm-hmm. So, does that answer?
Yeah, that's really cool.
Hey John, thanks for saving Digg. I'm a daily user, appreciate that.
Would you recommend it to a friend?
I would now. My sister actually recommended it back to me. I migrated away.
There you go.
I'm back.
And I think you didn't say it, but I think we resurveyed. And is anybody here from Digg? I think we resurveyed and I think 80% said they would now recommend.
It's very good. It costs me a lot of time. I have to try not to look at it because all the links are so good.
Yeah, it's great. Look, there's great content on the internet. I think we're doing a really good job with Digg, and I'm excited about that.
It's great.
Go for it.
So my question was, you mentioned when you were in business school how you went up to MIT and you saw the internet, and you were like ready to leave. You were worried you were going to miss it, that it was going to happen. I kind of felt that way about mobile. And I was wondering, like, if you think there's a similar thing, has technology sped up, or is mobile still happening and we're like in the midst of it, or is it gonna take a longer time?
Mobile's still happening. It's just starting. It's just like, you know, we put mobile through this very, very tight, like, you know, sort of prism of a desktop and a set of apps, and it's like, as it gets distributed out to all these other devices, it's still happening, right? The logical place, it is a receptor for data and for a Wi-Fi connection. And occasionally you want an immersive experience in it, but right now he wants to look at me, not immerse himself. He's trying to type at the same time. And that will help him when he's got something which he can actually take notes to, right? And so is that a watch? Is it glass? Is it an embed? I mean, we are bringing computing into the human experience. We're bringing computing into our bodies, right? It's happening. We're architecting this. This is like, it is, you know, the, we see sci-fi things like Terminator and we say, how bizarre and how weird, but we're doing that.
Singularity type thing, or?
Well, I mean, I think singularity, I mean, that's a whole nother, you know, you throw Kurzweil in there and you get into those assumptions about like the, I think that you have, it's undeniable the scale of processors, it's undeniable the curves associated with hard drives and with storage. I think that the scale curves associated with software development are not quite moving at the same pace. And so I don't see I don't think the thing becoming sentient anytime soon. But I think the network is itself becoming a thing. And it's a thing that we're creating as a reflection of ourselves. And we're putting so much of our love and life in it, and our kids and our dogs.
And our sense of identity.
And our identity and our words. Our words, right? Our, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years of like precious like words, right? We're putting all of those into this network thing, right? These things used to be very, very precious. And our ideas and our pictures and our, you know. And so we are, in a sense, creating that. And I think we need to be conscious of that, because we need to be conscious of the fact that we're building that. And we're the architects, right? And that sounds like a big lofty statement. It's not. It's just we're all trying to build our little piece of it. But we've got to be conscious of the whole, because there is a whole that's being built.
Okay, great.
Am I rambling?
No, you're fine.
Yeah. I was like, Don, are you out there? No. There was somebody I was going to have dinner with, but he's not here, so so we've gone long. Okay.
Sorry, Don. Let's keep going. Wherever you are.
Yeah.
We've got two more questions. Yeah. We're in the home stretch, John.
Yeah. Great interview, by the way. Thanks, Sarah and John. I have a question about thoughts. Can you tell us a little bit about the retention? Like, what is the biggest retention factor for long-term users of thoughts?
What does the retention numbers look like? So the retention numbers actually look pretty strong. You know, we look at second-day retention, we look at 30-day retention, and I'm not going to tell you what they are, because I tell you, it's the gaming companies. These are like, they're like machines about these metrics. They are up there in the sort of, you know, the top quartile. They're strong. And so we're happy with them. Can we make them better? Yeah. But well, long-term users, so it's been, I think it's been 7 weeks or something like that. So long-term user. I mean, I did this thing on CNBC, and this lady said to me, this lovely lady was interviewing me, she said, you know, my son's school, they've adopted dots now for kids who have, you know, some fine motor issues. Right, so who's like good for their fingers, particularly boys often have like middle school fine motor issues. And that the schools approved it as a tool. And I was like, the thing's been out there for 4 weeks and it's been approved by your school. And so it's very early days. It's very early days. Look, people seem to, they love the game. I mean, Patrick created a beautiful game. Yeah, I think it is it's something which hopefully doesn't demand too much of you. You know, what we've strived for is something which you'll love, but which you won't get burnt out because you feel like it's something you need to do all the time, like a candy high. And so what we want is we want sort of more. Want it to be more sustainable food source, and you know, not a Twinkie.
Okay, great. Last question.
This is Jeff Bonner from Jumpstart Wireless.
Hi.
And I was really engaged with your discussion of architectures and sort of layers and pieces using other pieces and building an ecosystem of parts. And I hope I haven't bastardized it too much in that summary. And that used to be a discussion heavily, that was all an enterprise discussion, enterprise IT discussion. And you're really talking about it in the consumer space.
Yep.
And I work mostly in the enterprise space.
Yep.
And so I'd be very interested in your thoughts about the enterprise and sort of how does that thinking play back into the enterprise, and what's the future of enterprise IT, and what's your, are you doing anything in that area?
That's a big one. I mean, I think that the consumers, you know, It's like, it's when it's late, it's easy to spout one line. It's the consumerization of IT, of enterprises happening. It is what's happening. I mean, I think you have, you know, a few vectors that influence this. You had a massive move to the cloud, right? Which meant all of this platform, all the stuff was cheaper, more available, and available anywhere. You had 2008, and you had a financial meltdown with a lot of pullback. And so I think a lot of corporations figured they could outsource their IT to their employees, right? So instead of giving this nice person a BlackBerry, they would say to him, why don't you go get an iPhone? That's a great idea. And so you'll buy it and you'll support it and you won't have to call IT and, you know, that's great. And we'll retire all those BlackBerries and then we'll get rid of the whole IT support department. And so I think that a lot of reasons why this happened, but it is fundamentally changing the way enterprises work. I think also, I mean, the advent of social is upending, you know, what we think of as the customer, right? And what, you know, the line between customer, company, and product development, right? I mean, I think it's insanely great that we have brands like GE and Dove who've come to like Digg and Tapestry and Giphy, you know, to work with them, to the small companies, right? So we have big brands who want to come work and figure out how they can tell stories, right? Because at some level, that's what brands do. But also integrate their products into this layer of innovation. And I think that we have, you know, the social revolution is, you know, breaking down the walls of the enterprise and is transforming the way that enterprises work with their customers, their suppliers, and you know, it's the unbundling of the enterprise, right? I mean, one of the great, you know, fascinating processes that goes on with the internet is the package gets unbundled, right? So, you know, first, you know, the newspaper package got unbundled, Craigslist over here and content here. Now we're seeing, you know, the enterprise become unbundled, and transaction costs become more efficient as it becomes unbundled. Mm-hmm. And we're seeing, you know, education becoming unbundled, right? Mm-hmm. We're seeing all these categories across society. This is what I was talking about, just like how we're re-architecting our world, is that we're unbundling all these things. And I think it's, yeah.
I haven't heard it described that way. That's interesting, unbundling. I mean, because it's like, in some senses, venture capital we were talking about different parts, you know, doing different aspects.
Yeah.
All right, we're in the home stretch.
Are we done?
Almost.
Set me free.
I have yes. two. You're almost
You said
three.
Last question.
I will have them. I have two final questions. Oh, okay. If you ever watched Japan a Month, you'd know these things.
Yes, okay.
But before we get to those, I want to thank our sponsors, Trinet and Venmo. Please either support them, download them, or just tweet something nice, or get your $10 from Venmo. And then tonight will have really been a bargain. And making that even more valuable, there's apparently like a shitload of cupcakes in the back of the room. So take cupcakes with you, take them to a loved one, give them to Venmo, do lots of things with them. There are cupcakes in the back. Don't forget your cupcakes by all means. All right, last two questions. What is the one thing you believe that few other people believe?
These sound like standard questions that you ask each time, yeah?
Yes.
Oh, thank you.
Again,
so that's
why
I should have watched the damn thing. what is one something that I believe that few other people believe? You know, I mean, I have infinite confidence in humanity and in our ability to, you know, create and recreate this world. I hope a lot of other people believe that. Uh-huh. Sometimes when I read, you know, watch the news and look at the media, I scratch my head and say maybe not. But I think that, you know, we're living in an unbelievable era of access and of creativity. Mm-hmm. What do I believe that, let me think of something more rarefied. I think the line between computing and between the interface and between data and between human thought is a lot grayer than we acknowledge. Mm-hmm. Normally, I think we think of this as something else, and it's it's not, it's us, and it's part of what we have created. And so, and I think that's, to me, that's hugely important to believe, because it makes us accountable mm-hmm. for what we've created and the follow-on effects of it, because I think technology has a grain to it. I think it has directionality to it. And I think that there are unintended consequences to things we build. And we need to, as builders, we need to own those responsibilities and live to them and, you know, see if we can make a better world through them.
Mm-hmm. That's a good answer. All right. I anticipate you'll have a good answer to this one. If you could have one mediocre superpower, what would it be? Would you like some examples of mediocre superpowers?
Like Russia?
Like Russia? Yes, you would take Russia.
Like a mediocre
superpower? No, like a supernatural power that has natural limits on it.
Oh, it's late.
No one has ever said Russia before. I will give you originality points. What?
God.
Would you like some examples?
No.
Okay.
I'd like to, one media.
Brazil, Japan.
Brazil's not mediocre. Well, Russia's probably not either. But yeah, but in the scheme of things.
What is a mediocre superpower? So I'll tell you the thing which first came to mind, which, the thing that first came to mind was the back button and the forward button. I think that the back button is like an incredibly powerful thing that was created and architected into the browser.
Uh-huh.
It'd be kind of fun to have one for life.
Uh-huh.
But I don't really want that because I think that the idea of being able to go back and like edit is just uninteresting. It'd be fun once, and then it would be like life would just be uninteresting with that.
That's similar to Dennis Crowley's. He said being able to like TiVo back in life by 5 seconds.
Yeah, but so a short back button would be interesting, but I think it'd be interesting for 5 seconds, and then you'd say that is a curse. That's the kind of technology that if you invented, I think you'd have to live with the consequences for a long time, because I just think that I think it would make life less interesting. What would be a 5 second forward button would be interesting. Let me think of some other things. Flight, does that count?
Well, you'd have to put limitations around it.
I have to put limitations. Like a short flight, right?
I mean, it's like can fly for 5 minutes or.
I would like to fly over the TSA, right? Just like if I could like skip that part of like check-in. That would be good. So that's short flight.
That's sort of meta, to fly to then get on a plane.
Yeah, but yeah, okay. But you said there's a limitation.
Right.
It's late. What other things can I think of? Yeah, nothing else comes to mind.
We'll accept flying.
Russia.
Over TSA.
I'll accept Russia.
Russia. You will be the only person to ever say Russia. Yeah. Thank you so much for doing this. It was great getting to know you more.